Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us this afternoon in a very busy time. So thank you students also for being part of this event. We're really thankful to have you here today. Before diving in, I would like to say a few words to introduce our lab, EPIDAPO. So EPIDAPO is a collaboration between UCLA and the French National Center for Scientific Research, CNRS. And it is it has the privilege of being hosted by the Institute for Society and Genetics at UCLA. So EPIDAPO stands for Epigenetics, Data, and Politics. And as the name suggests, our research focuses on the interface between life science and social science, focusing on drawing the social and moral implications of life science, biomedicine, biotech, in epigenetics, but also in other fields. And this is very much our approach today. Our guest speakers as a whole bring together many different perspectives: philosophy, sociology, medicine, genetics, history of medicine, advocacy. And we hope that this multiplicity of angles is going to help you to help us and you too tackle the topic of intersex. So some of you, of course, are familiar with intersex, some less. I just like to give a little background. So individuals with an intersex trait or a disorder of sex development, and I'll comment a little bit on these two names before in a minute. So there are people born with atypical sex characteristic, and that can be at the level of anatomy, gonads, or chromosomes. And it's easy to be under the impression that this is quite rare, and that was actually my impression before starting to study this field. And actually, it's not at all. There's no definite estimate of incidence, so that's another issue that we may want to discuss. But what incidence rate that is routinely quoted is 1 in 4,500 births for cases where gender assignment is uncertain. But if you count all the broad range of conditions involving some kind of intersex trait, that's as much as 1 in 200 births. So why are intersex people barely visible in either science or society at large? The obvious hypothesis is that there's here something really difficult to think, and that has a very large impact in terms of the care that we're going to bring. Medical care and more largely social care. Something difficult to think because we rely so much on the binary in sex, male and female, and the binary in genders. So the main course of action so far has been normalization, try to reassign people born with an intersex trait in either gender. This has been heavily criticized by activists since the 1990s and their allies. So they had a theorist in gender study who brought some tools to criticize the binary. And they also found some medical allies among doctors who were professionals who were starting questioning the standard of care. The reflection and mobilizations crystallized in 2006 in a consensus statement. It identified needs and initiated a number of important changes in clinical assessment and care of patients, also in scientific investigation of the conditions. So among the proposed change was the creation of registries, the change in nomenclature with disorder of sex development, or DSD as the new name, that would allow for a better scientific description of the conditions. It also advocated for a multidisciplinary approach and care with the better inclusion of parents, and it acknowledged the importance of peer support. The concrete result of that is in the US, the DSD, Translational Research Network, of which UCLA is part, a network of 10 research hospitals whose goal is to implement this clinical and scientific recommendation. They have a counterpart in Europe, the IDSD. Yet, 10 years after the consensus statement, the changes are still more limited than what could have been expected. And I will mention two points of dissent that are specifically significant and lingering. Points of dissent between mostly medical professionals and advocate or some advocates. So first, the DSD nomenclature. The new term was readily accepted by medical professionals, and it yielded obvious advantages in terms of diagnosis and descriptive power, and also it was advocated as a neutral term. Yet, because it has the word disorder in it, it's not that neutral, and it's been criticized by many advocates as another form of pathologization of these conditions. So the other view would be to describe these conditions as variations rather than disorders. Second point of dissent is the question of surgery on intersex children before they're able to consent by themselves. So this was one of the main thing that advocates wanted to change, yet surgeries have not disappeared at all. There's a much better, clearer process of consent, but they still exist. So there's a little question that all parties involved, be it advocates or medical professionals taking care of intersex patients, all parties have the common goal of achieving the best care for the patient. Yet the disagreement is on the means of achieving this best care. Is that, should that go through bodily normalization in order to promote the best psychological development for the children? Or on the opposite, should there be no attempt at medical normalization? And what kind of evidence is necessary to decide those questions? So these are some of the questions that we are going to be tackling today.